Welcome again to Impact 2020. On the second day, circulating around planetary alliances. After yesterday's first two episodes, the inspiring talk of Rosy Baidotti, an empowering, encouraging invitation for the joy of thinking about a future full of difference and radical equality. And the stunning introduction from Protectorama Toxica we have experienced here, and its sisters and brothers, and Johannes, and many others of them, which you still can be seen online on our website. We are today continuing, starting with an inside view into the research of the Institute of Applied Microbiology at one of the most prestigious technical universities in Europe, the RWTH Aachen. Today with us is Professor Gabriele Grammelsberger, who is going to host the talk between the guests in the second part, joined by Johanna Theurer from Munich, a curator. Sarah Johanna Theurer. Gabriele Grammelsberger is professor at the RWTH in Aachen. She is in charge of theory of science and philosophy of technology. Her research includes biotechnology and climate research, and her expertise in transdisciplinary thinking strongly resonates with our work here. And this has her made in the last years an important conversation partner for us. And very welcome, Gabriele, and I'm really happy that you introduce us to your colleague, Professor Lars Blank, who will be shortly here on my place. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Stefan. So I have the pleasure to introduce Lars Blank. He's a colleague of mine from the RWTH Aachen, which is a technical university, as you have heard. He is professor for applied microbiology. He is heading the Institute of Microbiology in Aachen. And you can say he's really in favor with microbes, and he will tell us something about it. He has two studies, one in chemical engineering and one in biology. He did his diploma thesis in the United States of America and his doctoral thesis in Australia. He then moved to the ETH Zürich before he came to Aachen, where we are very happy that you are in Aachen and I'm enjoying your talk.
Thank you. Thank you for the very nice introduction. And it's a real pleasure that I can be here tonight. And I chose an interesting title, I hope. But I don't have a microbe on my first slide. So it's an aerial photo from our institute. But I thought it's such an international audience that I would like to introduce just the location where we are working. Because 2 kilometers to the west, we're in the Netherlands. 3 kilometers to the south, we're in Belgium. But I would like to go ahead. All the research I can tell you is obviously the work of my group and of partners. So I would like to start with acknowledgements, but in a little bit different fashion. This is our group pictures from 2019. We do that on a yearly basis because there's a nice flowering of the cherry. This year in Germany, March was the true lockdown. So this is our group picture of 2020. But fortunately, we could make a small hike as the only social event this year, actually to the three triangular point where Belgium, Netherlands, and Germany meets. And so the acknowledgement is to my group. But microbes is the topic of my seminar. And I would like to give you a little bit of taste about the diversity, variety of microbes. You see different colors. I have also this guy with me. That's my favorite. It's a baker's yeast. And So I will come back to this one. And here you see an electron microscopy of a baker's yeast. It's a mother cell just budding off a daughter. And yeah, here, this you could produce almost from any air. If you put air on a gross medium, you get a wide variety of microbes. You see bacteria of different shape and color. You get different fungi, and you see this almost reminds one of a camembert fungi with this nice fluff. And there's a good reason why we learn as children that we wash our hands before we go and have a meal. You can do that on an agar plate, but then please be careful what you have there. So we live obviously with microbes. We live with a lot of microbes, and they're truly everywhere. We see them in our waterways. We see them maybe closer if you forgot to clean your bath. This is sometimes, maybe we shouldn't get that close. I really like blue cheese. This photo doesn't look that nice. And they can come to the extreme. We find them in the Antarctica. If there's some free moving water because of salt, other reasons, they can grow sub-zero degrees. They can grow up to 120 degrees in black smokers. They survive the driest areas of our planet and very different chemical means when you look in a geyser or a hot spring in Yellowstone. So you, everywhere where there's a chance that some energy is generated, you will find microbes. And actually, I had that slide before yesterday. Maybe there's something missing in this picture, because we estimate, depending on your gut, that we roughly are as many human cells, human, as bacteria, as microbes. So it's roughly the same number. Depends a little bit on your gut. This accounts to 500 grams to 1 kilogram of biomass of microbes. And if you just take one of these microbes, the maybe most famous, it's a gut microbe of humans. It's an Escherichia coli, it's called. It's the workhorse of biotechnology. I will not come back to this microbe, but it's the most famous. It can double every 20 minutes. They're microbes, they can double every 10 minutes. And we are now all experts in exponential growth due to corona. But if you just have a look here, what a microbe is doing, this is 2 hours of growth. 64 from one cell to 64 cells. Six generations. And if you then just make a calculation, this is the weight of our Earth. This is the weight of an E. coli. How many days, months would it take that an E. coli, if it has ideal growth conditions, every cell can double every 20 minutes, how long would it take that it weighs like the planet? I make it short, it's less than 2 days. And this is the problem of the exponential function, that we just can't grasp it as humans, and that may be also an issue in the corona crisis, at least at the start. That we use microbes for the good, and we often know them due to some not so nice encounters, if we had a sore throat or if we had some other disease. But if we look at food, we use them for centuries and often for food preservation. It's a pH, that it's sour, then other microbes can't do something. But nowadays, obviously, we play also with microbes, with food, because we would like to have very nice taste. And again, I'm a big fan of blue cheese. So this is just my microbe introduction. They're everywhere. They're champions of survival. If you give them opportunity, then we also sometimes they take these opportunities, and that means if you have just an open wound, if you have other problems with your immune system, then you maybe also get a problem with disease. And we use them already for millennia for our good. It's often from food, but nowadays we have the possibility of biotechnology, that we really can train these microbes for particular catalytic, for particular activities that they can help us to challenge, to overcome maybe also the biggest challenge. And that's the topic of the rest of my talk. Here you see again my little friend, and you may see here also, these are his scars when the daughter cells are budding off. And this happens maybe up to 20, maybe 30 times, and then the mother cell dies. These are the planetary boundaries. It's from one study, already 5 years old, but a very easy concept that we have certain boundaries we shouldn't cross. And this is a blue ring here. And what you see is that several are already crossed. Then there's a red line, and even some of these are crossed. And two of them are due to elements. This is nitrogen. Humankind learned how to use the nitrogen from the air, put it into fertilizers, and that's why we progressed so much in our agriculture. But we have an issue there. And phosphorus. I will leave out nitrogen. One could say a lot, but I will tackle phosphorus. And climate change. It's maybe not as serious here on this graph, but we know how challenging it is. And the last 5 years were not very encouraging. We experienced the warmest years and the windiest years as well. So I will check also carbon, because that's one of the major drivers of climate change, that we have too much carbon dioxide in our air. How did we get there? That we have now boundaries, yeah, seemingly crossed, and others are also a challenge. We have a very linear industrial system, and we were exploiting our resources. When we learned how to use coal, 100 years, 200 years later, we learned how to use oil and gas. We produced everything we needed for our well-being. And then, after use, we did a little bit of recycling, but after final use, it's all CO2 in the air. Too much CO2. Where do we have to go? And that would be then my argument for microbes again. No more fossil resources. Every ton of fossil resources in the soil is a good ton. Then we take the CO2 from the air. We are lucky this is established, because that's how our plants are doing it. They get the CO2, the carbon, from the air. They produce biomass. And we can use biomass to produce our materials we require. And I will argue we should not only use plants, because then we get maybe also other challenges of plant use, but we should also use here for the CO2 fixation, we should use microbes. And we have some internal recycling to do. But that's a large picture. And I would like to put here, and at different points, microbes. This is a stolen picture from an EU webpage. The bio-based economy, today it's a bioeconomy, maybe the circular bioeconomy. And we need catalysts to do so, that we produce everything of daily life, but not from fossil resources. I just can't overemphasize this. Trained organisms, and we are in Aachen, at my chair, we're working with bacteria, fungi, and yeast. Again, that's my yeast. The other guys, bacteria will come later. And when I say trained, what do we do? We take a cell, it can grow. So the fundamental aspects of life this cell is able to do, most often very efficient. But then we would like to have it that it does a certain catalysis, a certain production using a renewable resource. Here it's a simple sugar, produce a valuable compound which we usually produce from fossil resources. And then we need some enzymes, some internal material. We have to think about how it's arranged. You can imagine it's a free-living cell. It has also a cell wall. It has to be comparted from the environment. It has to be a unit in itself. So transport inside, so the substrate inside and the product outside is important. And then we, in dedicated reactors, we call them, in dedicated vessels, we cultivate these trained organisms, and then we produce everything what we require. Again, replacing material from fossil resources. And I would like to pinpoint that on two elements. Obviously, if you look what the different governments say which elements are crucial, you will find a far longer list than these guys. But I will focus on carbon and phosphate, on the C and the P. So carbon, we discussed this a lot. And really also the last person is should be convinced that we have an issue, and this issue of climate change is man-made. And this is the growth curve of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. And you see it correlates fairly well when we really kicked in with our industrialization, where we really used coal, and it then increased with utilizing oil and gas. If we look at a little bit more detailed and a little bit more into the time we are now living, you see this up and down, and there you also see the amount or the magnitude. These up and downs, this is summer, winter on the northern hemisphere. When our trees suddenly get leaves again, the carbon dioxide is removed, and in autumn and winter it's released again. That's why up and down, but you see the trend. We are above 400 ppm, and this is not a good sign. We can look into the entire carbon cycle, and you don't, yeah, it's too small. What it tells you is that the contribution of humans in absolute numbers is compared to the different mechanisms in the carbon cycle, not that huge. But the carbon added is added and disbalance the entire cycle. Where are microbes now contributing? Everywhere. It's really the photosynthesis. I pointed out, yeah, here at the end. We all the time think carbon fixation, photosynthesis, oxygen production is a task of plants. This is true, but 50% is done by microbes. 50% of the oxygen production is done by microbes. Then obviously we take the sugar and produce CO2. This a lot of microbes do. This is how we live. I don't know what you ate tonight. I didn't eat so much yet. But if you have the sugar, I'm living here on my lipids, and I'm exhausting the carbon dioxide. Lithotrophy, organisms can do so much. They can use CO2 and can do anorganic electrons, and they can fix the CO2. They don't need particular light. We have fermentation. This word you may have heard when you think about beer production, wine production. What is the product? A very nice one. It's ethanol. It's the alcohol. Fermentation product, but lactic acid, other products is methanotrophy. we can feed microbes also with methane. But unfortunately, maybe also sometimes fortunately, we can produce with microbes methane. We can give them almost any other biomolecule, sugars for example, and they produce methane. That's what we do if you go to a biogas plant, maybe at your local water sewage plant. However, some of these reactions, they also don't help us. Some of them we can put into place. I will argue for that, that we particularly can use them to address the challenge, but some are running in nature directly. You have heard about that cows produce methane. This is partially true. It's really produced by the bacteria of the cow. And methane is a far stronger climate gas. And now Siberia, the permafrost soil is getting too high temperature, the ice is gone, and the microbes can use enormous amounts of biomass to produce more methane. This is not good. And I just, with some old data, I couldn't find of the Amazon new data, but it tells you that the immediate impact what human does and what microbes do maybe don't correlate. This is telling you up to 95 or so that too much carbon is released. So zero would mean the forest does not release carbon. Minus would mean it actually does some carbon fixation. But in total, the Amazon already in the 90s of last century lost carbon. But why? Because human burned the trees. That's an old, and it most likely the numbers look really appalling now with all the news. But you see, burning, it adds something. But actually, on some of the freed land, there's also new plants, so they fix some carbon. And how do we get now to the blue line? Yeah, this is microbial degradation. All the biomass which is left after burning is digested by microbes, and they release the carbon. And you get the high loss and the high CO2 production. We should count that in. So now on a positive, that we, if there's these great possibilities that microbes can do, can we also tackle these challenges? And that's what we do in biotechnology. CO2 from the air is fixed by plants, and we feed the plants to microbes, and they produce something of interest. The major product, I should have maybe put here some food, I could have put here some ethanol directly, I put a biotech product. This is a detergent where we could, for example, substitute oil-based, crude oil-based biosurfactants from hand washing liquids via this biomolecule. But this is how biotechnology is now these days done. On this level, we can discuss a lot. There was huge discussion. In Germany, you can buy a certain fuel for an auto engine. It's called E10 because there's 10% bioethanol in there. And there was a huge discussion if land use is a problem, that the prices of our bread goes up, etc. It's about 3%, 4% of our land use in Germany that we produce something for bioethanol. But it's still worthwhile to discuss it. Is there an alternative? Can we skip the plant fixing the carbon dioxide? And I'm sorry, it's a little bit more complicated slide, but I hope I don't lose you. If we manage, and this is a big if, this is also in my sentence down here, if we want to make the chemical sector, make this bioeconomy a reality, the chemical sector carbon neutral, we have to get carbon neutral energy. And here it's solar panels, it's wind, and you know about the discussions and about the progress. In some areas it looks encouraging, but now everyone would like to have these carbon, this green energy. What can we do with it? We can, for example, produce hydrogen, and then microbes can directly, with hydrogen and carbon dioxide, do what plants also do, fix the carbon dioxide, and we can either train them to produce the product of interest. I have one example from a company. They do something special. Or you produce with untrained but highly performing cells that they produce acetate. Acetate is our vinegar acid, what you smell when you smell vinegar. And this you get instead of sugar from a plant, you could also feed this acetate to microbes and produce everything what biotech can do. And you can feed some other side streams. And we argue that one can also feed some of the plastic. And I will come back to that aspect. This is the ethylene glycol here, the E from PET bottles. And this is one example. And I thought I'd pick this because we are very close to Duisburg. Duisburg is the last or second last of the large steel manufacturing cities in Germany. And these steel manufacturers, they have syngas, they have coke gas. And this is a mixture of CO2 again, so of our carbon of the atmosphere, but high concentrated. They get also hydrogen, the hydrogen I wanted from green energy, but they have it directly because they burn actually coal. And they get carbon monoxide. And interestingly, there are microbes. If there are enough electrons, if there's enough energy in this mixture, they can use it and fix it. And there are proposals to produce ethanol. And actually, this is one of the few examples where large-scale plants are already at a steel site with microbes. Instead of burning it, producing more CO2, they produce chemicals, fix the energy, and fix the carbon dioxide. This is quite exciting. I would like to have another positive spin on the microbes, and this is cleaning up the environment. And also, I thought I'd pick this because in the Ruhr area, we had steel and we had coal. And when you have coal, you make the coal for the steel plant. And this is a very dirty business, especially in the 19th century. That was hugely dirty. And we have soils. They were contaminated. I know one 17 meters deep with aromatic, with compounds. They're not nice. One thing you can do, you can inject microbes that they clean it up. And hopefully you get to green areas again. I explain a little bit different technology. This is our wastewater treatment. I couldn't find old pictures of the Rhine and other rivers, so I picked some appalling rivers here, but we don't have to look far. In Europe, the rivers looked not much different 60 years ago or so. And if we look very close, again, Essen, where we are, I'm living in Dortmund, it's very close to the spring of this river. It's the Emscher. And this is, in some areas, still in 2020, an open sewer. And 20 years ago, it was decided to renature it. And this was really, a lot of technical reasons, it was for 2.5 million people, the wastewater treatment or the wastewater channel. This was a river previously, then it was an open sewer, and after renaturation, nature can grasp this water body again. And this took a lot of technologies, a lot of money, this is in the high billions, much times, as I said, 2 decades, and a lot of microbes. and I will argue again for the microbes. And to do something like this, to clean up the wastewater of 2.5 million people, you need wastewater treatment plants. Again, these are not the ones from the Ruhrgebiet, but these are huge ones from other areas. And here, especially in these aerated tanks, the enormous amounts of microbes, these are the settlers to remove the microbial biomass. And this is truly the success story of environmental microbiology, that we have the technology to clean up water. There's no need at the, anymore that we waste our rivers. And we should argue that for the entire world, I know this is not the reality for a lot of people on this planet. So we have the technology, and if we want, we can do it. We can even renature the Emscher. And the Emscher is really a tough part. The question is, how fast can we do that? And in some aspects, I'm positive because we have technology. In some other aspects, I'm maybe a little bit less positive. If we microbes can eat almost everything in our wastewater, what else can they, where else can they help us? And I would like to tackle another challenge which has to do something with our carbon and our use of fossil resources to our daily life. And that's most likely not very surprising to you. It's a plastic challenge, that we really face a plastic crisis. We lose too much plastic to the environment. It's estimated to be 8 million. There are some scenarios out there that this will increase to 40 million, hopefully. And we see a lot of effort. Hopefully, we can reduce it rather. And it was already yesterday mentioned that we may also inhale it, and via our food chain, we may eat it as well. So we really would like to do something. Just a look, we got really excited about the possibility of polymers. We developed new materials, understand better what we can do. Then China, especially China, but Asia kicked in. They also understood how to produce it every time cheaper, every time better, with more applications. And now it's of daily life, and we are close to 400 million tons per year of novel produced plastics. And this is more than 99.5% from fossil resources. We have a few bioplastics. There's technology, but very few. So we really face a challenge. We face a challenge on the end of life. We think about the bag in the environment, but actually we face also on the front, as I said, we have to leave the carbon in the soil. And it's already estimated 4 to 6% of all crude oil is for plastics, and this will increase dramatically because the amount of plastic used is estimated to double again in the next 2 decades. And we should just not let it happen. This is more what we, when we think about plastic crisis, we may picture. We have the plastic in the ocean. Sure, this is an issue. It's an issue everywhere, but particularly in Southeast Asia, a lot of ocean, a lot of beaches, and a lot of people living there. And what we are discussing, especially also in Germany, microplastic, but the microplastic in your body lotion, this makes such a small part of all the plastics we also lose in Germany, but it's still good to not have it. I would like to introduce you to an EU project where we take now microbes, the metabolic activity of microbes, to also contribute to ideas and technology that we make and recycle also the toughest mixed plastic. And for this, I will come on the next slide trying to explain it another time. But we have certain proteins, enzymes, which can degrade the long polymers, the plastic. Plastics are made of monomers, of single substitutes, and they're degraded, and these we call it hydrolysis. So the plastic is from a long chain cut down to small pieces. And these small pieces we feed to microbes, and these microbes live on it as a carbon source, as an energy source, and they produce bioplastic. We have some really technical issues. There are very few pure plastics. They are often with additives, with colors. You know your different materials. So we have separation, we have engineers there, and we have also the chemists on board. And yeah, please visit our weekly blog if you're interested. Mix up. These things you don't do alone. This is a project, you may have seen it on the logo. It's also in Chinese. The EU Commission argued, yeah, it's very nice that Europe is tackling it. Europe is producing roughly 18% of all plastic in this world. China itself produces 30% of all plastic produced. So if we really would like to make an impact, it's a good idea to combine both, and we at least cover 50% of all plastic. And you see the different people involved. I just would like to give you a flavor. What plastic, recycling, and microbes? So what is the contribution there? As I said, we have these polymers, and here it's a PET. P stands for polymer, or, and the E for ethylene glycol, the T for terephthalic acid. And these are two of the substituents, two of the pieces. And you see it's very regular, yellow, green, so E, T, E, T. And then we have these single pieces. If you go to your foam mattress, to your car seat, to the filling of this guy, then you're most likely at polyurethane, PU, then it gets more complicated. You see there are different colors, more different pieces. This works. For a PET bottle, enzymes can degrade the PET bottle. Then we can feed these different constituents to a microbe, and it can foster, it can grow. And what we also train these microbes, and I forgot my little helper here. This is a Pseudomonas. This is a rod-shaped bacterium. It's far smaller than a baker's yeast, actually. This is a micron. This may be 5 to 10 microns. This one, from these monomers, it can produce a polymer. It's actually like we have lipids on our belly. That's how the excess carbon a microbe can store. It can store it as a polyester. And we then train the microbe that it releases this polyester. And I would like to give you a little bit an insight in these different steps. And here there is a PET film by our colleagues. And they use a certain catalyst enzyme, also from bacteria, actually from a thermophilic, which grows at 70 degrees. And then you see the color changes, and if you weigh, there's a lot of weight loss. So it can really tackle this plastic. And this is very technical. On the y-axis, you have how much of these single constituents, of these pieces are produced, of these monomers. And at the end, after 100 hours, the polymer is gone, the plastic is gone, and there's only monomers. And then you get this liquid, and they send it to us in Aachen, and we feed our microbes now with the plastic constituents of a plastic bottle, of a plastic film. And we can do this with all different kinds of material. Here are the chemical formulas, not that important, but here is the T of the PET, the E of the PET, and some of the PU of the polyurethane. And the orange is all the time growth, how much biomass is produced. And the blue bar is how much plastic is produced. And you see even very complex structures from plastic can be used now as a carbon source. And what can you do now with this bioplastic? And we argue that we require some bioplastic because we put purposefully plastic into the environment. And this is one example. In agriculture, there's a lot of reasons why we use agricultural foils. This is actually a very enriched bioplastic from microbes. And you see the plant is not fully developed, but the mulch foil, this is still an academic exercise, is already degraded. So this is maybe too good. But these kind of materials you could produce, it does not have to be more fossil material into the environment. And we argue about circularity as all, but I would like to guide you through this complex slide, maybe complex. But you, on the first view, see there's no fossil resources. I can't repeat myself too often. We argue the amount of new material has to be reduced. We have to reuse our plastic more often. We have to, then, if it's not possible to reuse, we have to do mechanical recycling. And we see some really encouraging developments. But then there will be the majority of the plastic. And there we argue for chemical, biochemical recycling, just via the route I was proposing. Degrading it via enzymes, maybe also via chemistry, if that's better, and then feeding microbes to produce everything of interest. We know that we lose, when we use plastic, that we lose plastic to the environment. This plastic is not allowed to be, as estimated for polystyrene, for other plastics, to linger around for 4 centuries. We called it emergency biodegradation. So if we lose plastic to the environment, think about your rubber tire. Think about other aspects of wear and tear here. And but think about also maybe a little bit of littering. But obviously, we shouldn't have littering. This is also not the issue in quite a few of the developed countries, it's an issue in many others. So there, we have to come up with new material which has an emergency biodegradation, and there are ideas out there. And obviously, all the plastic we purposefully put into the environment, they have to be biodegraded in an okay time. These maybe in years, it does not have to be weeks or days or what is proposed sometimes. It has to go also with a function. But this one, the intentionally released, it needs a biodegradation function. I'm excited about the possibilities and sometimes discouraged. And this is one. I could have picked almost every other development. It's all so fast. Our growth, our society, our economies are growing so fast. And this is just one example. Textiles, clothes. We are here somewhere. And the gray bar is polyesters, and it adds a little bit with the orange. There's some polypropylene, there's some other synthetic fibers. And when you check, there's up to 2030, there's a doubling, another 50 million tons of polyester just required for textiles. And we have no clue how to recycle textiles. It's a mixture, it's complicated, there are a lot of additives, there are colors. Very difficult. A lot of people working on it, but the challenge, and when you think about how textiles are also produced and where, then you see the true challenge and the environmental burden. And this is just one small peak where you may have not seen plastic as a major driver. But on the other hand, some things are sometimes super fast. There was in Germany, a law that recycled PET was not allowed in food. But if you have a water bottle, suddenly you can produce via mechanical recycling a water bottle again. And we see now this commercial, but we see in front of the major news at 8 o'clock in the evening, so the most expensive prime time, we see that mineral water is advertised via the bottle. How could you imagine that someone tries to sell a product via the bottle? The same is true for this liquid detergent, where this company is, for the last 30 years or so, on environmental view and front runner, it's a comparable small company, but they advertise they have already used 300 million tons of recycled PET. It's easier, not food, but it's very good. So some developments are suddenly fast because the awareness of the customer and suddenly a market pull, which I would argue is very important, because all the technologies I'm telling you today suffer one aspect, and this is price. Our oil is so cheap, the virgin plastic is so cheap that it's, we have to get into pricing of CO2 or of mineral oil or something, that we have the true cost of our linear economy. I think I'm still in time. I do my last few slides. I change the topic to phosphate, maybe not as known, and I start into this phosphate with this slide. It was on a Nature article, and it's not directly easy to see what you actually see there. It's a disappearing nutrient, but what you see there is actually a mine of phosphate rock in the North African desert in Morocco. And this is a huge crane which is doing the soil movement. And this is how we run at the moment our planet. That's how we guarantee that we produce enough food, enough plants. Nitrogen via a chemical fixation, and phosphate from the desert. And if you look how that looks over time again, we can use some material, some manure, especially from animals. There's hardly any possibility, at least not in Europe, that we can use biomass from wastewater, because too many pharmaceuticals, too many heavy metals. This was done decades, centuries, that humans understood that manure can fertilize their plants. And that's how we actually manage to feed the planet. We use phosphate rock and fertilize our plants. And again, this is a resource which will end. And there's two other aspects to it. One is, if you don't feed phosphate, you have a sick plant. This is clear. If you put too much phosphate into the environment, you get growth of algae and others, and you really hurt your water bodies. And you can see that on large areas. This is a Caspian Sea. This is huge growth of some algae. This is all the time intertwined with nitrogen, but I skipped nitrogen. There's another aspect to it, and for me this is still very, very intriguing and has a lot of consequences. This is how our phosphate resources are distributed in this world. Roughly 75% is in Morocco. And here correctly in Western Sahara. You may know that Morocco doesn't agree that there's a Western Sahara, but the people living there, they strongly believe that there's a Western Sahara. You see there are a few others. And then you can see who is producing phosphate. And you can imagine if you have 1.3, 1.4 billion people, you need some phosphate. And if you have own resources, you use them. China will run out in the next 30 years or so, 40 years of phosphate of own resources. The same estimate for the United States. They have fewer resources. They also use their own phosphate for the agriculture. So in a few decades, we will be all customers of Morocco. Europe is already. And interestingly, I was allowed 2 years back to be in Morocco. Even the cab driver knew that good times are ahead. How is our phosphate cycle looking? What was the native one and what is the one we influenced? We have phosphate rock. Naturally, over time, over a very long time, there will be erosion of these areas, also very naturally. But you can imagine, if it's in the northern Sahara, it's very slow because there's so very little runoff. It takes really a lot of time. Then it goes to our water bodies. In our oceans, it will directly precipitate with the few metals around. It'll hardly be any soluble phosphate around, so it will fall to the ground. What will happen there? Marine sediments are formed, and on a very Earth scale, these sediments suddenly, via tectonic changes, will come back out of the ocean and be, for example, in the northern Sahara. The northern Sahara was at one point the bottom of an ocean. What do we do now? We do phosphate mining. We produce our phosphate fertilizer. We put it on our fields. And luckily, the diffusion is not very high, so the mobility of the phosphate is not very high. So in Germany, we have some soils. In theory, you don't have to fertilize it for the next 200 years. So much phosphate is in there. The bad thing is that the plants can't get to them because it's complex with other metals. But we lose some soil. We lose it to our water bodies. And at the end, over a longer time, we lose it again to our ocean. Some we lose directly. It's fairly slow process in maybe in Germany, in some other parts of Europe, in other areas where erosion is a far harder topic, we lose it even quicker. We do some recycling. We use the manure of our animals, put it back. But this is just a little bit extending the life of the phosphate before it's getting a sediment. And now this is the time frame of this cycle, 10 to 100 million years. And you know, that's not good for us. This is far too slow. So we have to do something. And just to emphasize again, the growth is still there. We still see that phosphate demand is growing. In Europe, not that much growing anymore because we have fertilized them for decades. Our soils are fairly saturated, but we have so much soil which hasn't seen phosphate and hasn't seen the good harvest, so there will be more demand. Peak P, you have maybe heard that of oil. When is the highest mining of phosphate done? And from there, it goes down. It's very difficult. Some people say it's already in 50 years. That would be a problem. Others say more conservative, 300 years. We have still some time. So I could, I will show you again one microbial application. This is research for quite some time. It's operating in some wastewater treatment plants, but most often it's too costly, too unstable. How does it work? Your phosphate-rich biomass enters and you have a particular control that you have an anaerobic, no air, an aerobic zone, and then some microbes collect the phosphate and they're up to 50% suddenly phosphate. And you can harvest this biomass and remove the phosphate and recover it. The bad thing is, it's really phosphate. It has to compete again with mined phosphate. Mined phosphate is still dirt cheap. So this technology is not cheap, and it's contaminated with pharmaceuticals and with heavy metals. So in theory, we have it in place. It works for removal. This is important. Our runoffs are phosphate-free. In Germany, we often do complexing. We use metals. We don't use microbes. But the recovery of the phosphate, it's not an established technology everywhere. And we in Aachen work on a different aspect, because we think we need more value, because the price is so low on the fertilizer, it's no possibility. We need a product which has more price. And we use, again, my favorite organism, the baker's yeast. And I'm sorry that it's a little bit complicated, but that's it also for tonight. We use agricultural side streams. Here, rapeseed press cake, canola seed press cake. And this contains 1.5% of phosphate. And there's a certain enzyme which a partner of us in biotechnology can engineer. We again purposefully change the activity, and we can produce now phosphate depleted, and we still can feed that this, for example, animal fodder. But now we have phosphate, free phosphate in the water, and this is done by our colleagues. And we do now hyperaccumulation of this phosphate, but not just to remove it from the water, as in wastewater treatment, but to produce polyphosphate, a long chain, a polymer again. And it can accumulate up to 30% of its dry weight, this yeast, polyphosphate. And polyphosphate is more expensive, and that's why you can afford also another process. And what can we do with it? This is just very technical. You starve it first, that it's really hungry for phosphate. You hardly can measure anything. After 10 hours, you give a lot of phosphate, and we call it hyperaccumulation. Up to 30% of its body weight is then suddenly polyphosphate. And what can you do? You can produce yeast extract, and you can produce polyphosphate. And both is more pricey, clearly more pricey than phosphate fertilizer. And we hope to contribute at least in this area some technology that we can leave the phosphate or need less per year from the African desert. Now I'm at the end of my time, and I'm at the end of my seminar. What I wanted to share with you, that microbes can contribute to an even faster climate change, to do biomass degradation. There are really some challenges ahead, but we can technically also capture CO2 with them. We can capture phosphate, and with microbes, we can clearly contribute to the circular economy. I'm fully convinced without microbes, we will not achieve it. And the question is, are we fast enough against the other developments? And with this, I'm at the end of my seminar. Thanks for your attention, and I'm looking forward to some questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Lars Plenk, for this really wonderful insight into the world of our new friends for tonight, I think, the microbes. And yeah, we now have some time again for questions from the online audience. And I think the last sentence you said is exactly what one person is asking from our live stream. The question is, in terms of the many planetary challenges, where do you currently see the biggest potential in the combination of technology and organisms, or technological and organic processes, especially with regard to solution-oriented approaches, if we assume that we don't have much time left? So climate change is progressing very fast. Is there still enough time to implement the techniques you presented?
Yeah, this is for sure the very important question, and I think at least for transition technology, although the discussions of the last 10, maybe 20 years didn't run well, I would still argue to rethink some contributions of biofuels. We have extremely good, we call it life cycle assessment, how much contribution to reduction of CO2 in the air can these fuels deliver. And we know we now have new technologies. We have batteries, we have maybe even hydrogens for some of our cars. But the rate of progress is so slow. We have all the combustion engines. This would be one of my arguments that, and we have the technology to produce biofuels, also from resources which don't compete with food. So this would be one, because we have the technologies, we have even in some places the plants there, but they don't pay off because the crude oil is so cheap. But we know, again, crude oil, please stick it in the, leave it in the ground. But if a company can't make a living, then it closes also the biofuel. So biofuel, because it can contribute next year, at least to some extent. And the second one, I'm very happy about an extremely rapid development, and this is meat replacement products. And this is, you can look into all the difference, if it's pea proteins, if it's other plant material, we see fungi cultivated, we see all other means how to make a burger that it actually tastes nice, maybe get even the same taste, again, actually, thanks to a trained yeast, where it's the burger even bleeds and has the same metallic taste like a barbecued burger. And why am I so excited? Because land use, cereal use, if I would ask you how much cereals do we eat and how much do we, of all the cereals produced? And in Europe, it's less than 25% we eat. We feed more than 55% to our animals. If we reduce this, we come out of land use, and suddenly we could spend also some time on biodiversity, etc. So these developments is the second one, where I see that it's quick at the moment, there is enthusiasm, people can make a living on it. It's still more expensive than meat. This is, for me, still ridiculous that a meat burger is cheaper than a plant-based burger, but that has a lot of, yeah. And there is the second one. So these two are things which change, not in 20 years something, but they can have now an impact. And then obviously we're facing the challenge that more of this world becomes middle class. And then we see these developments, for example, also in India, that suddenly the demand is for meat goes up because people can afford it. Also, cultural, historically, they had nothing to do with meat. But this is a different development. But for biotech, these would be my first two. And we see real enthusiasm. And we see animal identical proteins produced with yeast again.
Another question from the live stream, which kind of connects to, I think, the answer you just gave. Leon asks or says, "I'm totally with you that in the existing system, we should tax the use of fossil resources to reduce the consumption in a free market economy. But do you really think that there can be a green capitalism? Isn't another planned economy necessary to stop climate change and environmental pollution? Because in a society of money, there's always an interest in cheap but toxic use of our resources. And as you say, recycling and cleaning is expensive."
Yeah, I'm still in this sense optimistic, and we see so many initiatives also on a political scale. But at the end, you see you saw the examples of this water bottle. I know it's contributing in the total picture little, but that the customer, the consumer, suddenly seems to buy a water rather than via only the price, maybe only the magnesium content. I don't know. I never did that, but via the bottle, this is somehow encouraging. But only via the consumer, it's impossible. We need a frame where companies can play in, and I think the idea put down and now put hopefully also in full practice, we touch the Green Deal and others on the EU level, but that CO2 gets a price, and a price which is plannable increasing, that is really truly important. Do we manage that on a global scale? There I'm less optimistic, but people also from other countries would like to sell products into the EU, and then they have to sustain the same rules, and we have to also do the controlling. We see it with our clothes, with all these problems, but I don't come up with a system which is beyond, let's call it, green capitalism.
Thank you.
Okay, I have a question from Sina, and she has a question for you. For example, modern planning of cities has strong roots in the concept of sanitation, which results in clean surfaces as a visual to humans' rational ability to frame nature, where all sorts of organisms, such as microbes, aren't welcome, perceived as uncontrollable and dangerous. A very structurally linear concept, as he said, where resources go in on one side and waste goes out on the other, and it's up to the biosphere to close the loop. I feel there's a lot of resistance opening up to concepts like Lars presented and how to raise awareness among a wider public that all that isn't something outside of us in order to be able to integrate microbes in our built environment.
Yeah, sure, if you look where the sewage plants are, they are obviously often try to be separated from housing places. I fully agree that this, but one also has to agree that this part of microbes is dangerous. Pathogens can live on humans, we know, and this is why the Emscher was actually put into a kennel, because we had all issues of diarrhea in this area, and this was mainly by microbes. So put it closer to circulation. Integrating it maybe in larger houses where decentralized. I know a few ideas. Often, again, they don't pay off at all because of the low oil price. I can't come up with that too often. The ideas of locally producing biogas, capturing, maybe you may know the separating pee from poo, and then the pee includes the phosphate that you may separate that already in your house. Okay, in larger houses with more people in there, then it maybe is worthwhile. In Hamburg, I know one of these houses. But I agree, it's not easy, And at the moment, we dilute everything. So we transport our waste by diluting. And obviously, having it diluted and then concentrating it again, it's challenging. It would be sometimes better being more decentralized, but that's difficult. I agree. Yeah.
There's another question from our participants who are joining us via Zoom. Juan Pablo asks a question that for me very much also connects to the talk we heard yesterday by Rosy Bredotti, who challenges the notion of the human and what constitutes the human. And Juan asks, thinking about other ontologies, we could say that instead of us training microbial life, it trains us, further complicating the separations of us, humans, from our surroundings. In other words, where does the human end and where does bacteria begin? Wouldn't you say that before bioengineering even attempts to fix anything, it's important to first shift our ideas of who uses who and who trains who and for what purposes?
The last one, obviously, I don't sign up because not much thinking. We take a fermenter, we take the training spots, the training labs, and we start with biotech and haven't thought about this idea. But I fully agree, and there's quite some a lot of evidence and that humans develop also with their microbes, and the microbes develop with the humans. And there is a, if you think about pathogens, there's a warfare. I have a few examples. We produce a particular organic acid. It looks a little bit like our citric acid, our acid from a lemon, one carbon less. We produce that as a human by the immune system to inhibit growth of microbes. What do? They develop a degradation pathway to get rid of it, and then they grow again on us. So this warfare is going on in evolution, but also on the positive side, we have our positive microbes. They produce our vitamins. They help us digesting, this is what we have in the gut. And there's more and more evidence that indeed there's a very strong correlation, and it's for sure not that we can think about a human and separate. Without microbes, you're not a very healthy person.
Thank you. I think that's a great ending sentence. We will enter a short break now, and after that we'll be waiting for you with a talk, a roundtable talk with all of our participants, who will be joined by Gabriele Grammitzberger and Sarah Johanna Theurer. And stay with us, we'll be back in a few minutes.
Welcome back to our discussion. We have now more guests than before. We have Rosi Praidotti on the screen. We have Johannes S. Protectorama Generalis here with us today. And we have a new guest, Sara Johanna Theurer. She is a curator at the Haus der Kunst in Munich, which is a house for modern kunst, modern art, sorry. Art. We have to switch to English. We just talked in German. And she hosts Portals, which is a show on Kashmir Radio Berlin, focusing on process-oriented art practices. And as I know, you're a historian of art. This was your training, or?
Not exactly, no.
We talk about this okay. A minute later. Yeah. So we had the very great talk by Lars, and we now know that we are living together with microbes, and we hope that microbes will save us. And I want to make, so during yesterday and today, listening to the talks, I found something which I think is very positive. So the good news, I think, of all the crises we are facing at the moment, and there are a lot of crises, I think, is that we become more and more aware. So when we, maybe the older ones of us, when we look back 20 years ago, so we were not that aware about environmental issues or about other issues. So I think there is a collaborative learning at the moment pushed by the crisis, and this is, I think, a very positive thing. And I would like to ask Rosi, how you see that. So do you see that, or would you share my idea that we see a new awareness and that this is something which is a very good news?
So hello, everybody. Nice to be here. And hello to the audience. Great that you're so loyal to us. So it depends a bit on who the we is. It is absolutely true of the university, of the research community, that the question of the environment was taken for granted. It's not something that was primary in humanities and social sciences. The humanities and social sciences are very anthropocentric. We study human beings. We study the identities of humans, the suffering of humans, the revendications of humans, particularly in critical theory. And critical theory was very, the left, very, very anthropocentric. And I mentioned briefly last night the bad relationship between green politics and red politics, not very friendly. I remember a very major American feminist when I was a graduate student coming up to me and saying, I'm glad that you're doing philosophy of subjectivity because there are so many people out there that are soft in the head. And being soft in the head meant that you did environmental things. You were a tree hugger. You did these ridiculous things. So I think there's something about critical theory not taking in the pain of the world and prioritizing the pain of humans. And I think that makes the humanities and social sciences today a little bit more old-fashioned than life sciences and biotechnologies. We heard Lars talk about the fact that our bodies are colonies of bacteria. So even the idea, my body, myself, our bodies, ourselves, colonies of bacteria. And we heard Johannes talk about the multiplicities of possible levels of selves and becoming. So multiplicities and complexities don't go easily with a certain tradition of critical theory. So I think indeed we've come a long way. We are learning, but you know, Rachel Carson, the Silent Spring, is 1961. Mm. The term ecofeminism, Françoise Dobon, is 1974. So the ideas and the theories were there. They just didn't resonate. We have come a long way in that respect, yes.
Yeah, thank you. So, and I think, so the you said it, multiplicity is a very important topic. And what really interests me is the discussion between Lars and Protectorama, because you have the experience of multiplicity yourself as you are, and as, what is the plural, as you, of you, as we are? No, you said it yesterday so nicely.
I as us.
And Lars is doing the research about it, so this would be a very nice experience to learn more about.
Well, I would like to add as us. And I think it might have become clear in
for example, the question and answer yesterday is that I struggle to speak as us. Even though this is what I do, it's a struggle. It's not easy to decenter yourself as many. And it's a practice. It's a practice that is continuous, and it's it has setbacks and it has failures, and then it's like these moments, like these 2 days here where I can fully embody the multiplicity, but then there is like the everyday life in which, you know, we as us are recentered into this subject, into this identity that's fixed and that's stable. And it has to be stable before functioning, right? And I think that's maybe a kind of a throw to you, like these functions, these functionalities, these solutions that we as humans develop in order to stabilize ourselves, to fix ourselves, to make ourselves selves. I think these are basically also in what the questions were posed to you are at the center, I think, of what we are grappling with, all of us as humans, is like we have made a world that functions, that is effective, that is fast, that is growing, but it's truly sick and it's truly dying. And I think in order to revert that and make a world that's not functioning and that's complicated and that's multiple and that's like really complicated, we have to revert our whole thinking, not just the thinking, the theory, but ourselves as selves, as stable, fixed, stable identities. And this is something that's a struggle. It's not going to be easy. And so I, as us, also fail and crumble.
Lars, you like to add something?
I'm just in these 2 days exposed to so many new ideas and aspects. I see that my thinking is very, let's call it positive focused, but I guess there's a lot of missing a lot of points. How we live healthy with our microbes. They're even now, because we get technologies that we can actually learn with whom we live. There are now companies out there, they sell us essays, they sell us information for 60 US, 80 US, and they try to tell us who is living with us and what is healthy and what not. But one has to admit, we just don't know. And at the moment, there's a lot of correlation. There are even some people saying that that humankind is getting heavier all the time. Is a disease because we just have the wrong microbes and we get more carbon into our body, which people previously wouldn't have got, because it's an infection. I'm more on a chemical engineer. I think it's a carbon balance, and if you eat too much, then you get bigger, maybe. But we will learn in the next years, decades. But at the moment, we know more about disease. So if we have single microbes, that's not good. If we have a lot of different microbes, it's often better.
Yeah, but I mean, the interesting aspect is that yesterday we heard talks about the global scale of collaborative thinking and be open and so on. This is a very interesting view into the micro scale that we also share a lot and that we are aware of. And I think in your performance, you presented it so perfectly, which is in a way a chain between these two scales, which is interesting, I think. And I want to ask Sarah, I mean, you know more about Johannes as Protectorama and so on work, how you see this, how difficult for an artist it is to switch these identities.
I think it's not only difficult for artists to begin with. I think, obviously, as an artistic practice, So we see that as a sort of narration and artistic practice, right? As a potential reality or as something that is suggested and that people can engage with by suspending of disbelief. So maybe this is the easiest way to engage with these kind of thinking. And I was just, I hope that's not too heretical, but I was just thinking when you were talking about these like microbes that look like animals that I think they're not that different actually to what Protectorama might present to us as in terms of complexity or as, you know, a multiplied being. But they're like almost like Tamagotchis. I mean, they look like pets. And this is something where I see a problem maybe or a question that I would like to pose. And because they are like pets, and you were saying also we teach the microbes something, I was reminded of this child metaphor that we often apply also when we think about AI and art, but also in our relation to it. And since we're talking about social orders and communities, is this a healthy relationship if we think about them as children or not?
Yeah, maybe I should turn them around because these eyes are very... obviously, you have seen also the electron microscopy. That's why I thought this was important as well. There are some structures where some microbes, also on that scale, can detect where the light comes from. They can orientate themselves in the direction of sun. It's not an eye, but it's a protein. But most of the... and for sure, they don't have eyes like this. Yeah, for me, we also the sheer number we have in one reactor, or if you buy your yeast as a cube, these 30 grams, if you count how many cells you have and you put in an oven, before they obviously make a nice bread, I don't see an issue there at all. And that's why... yeah, I don't have also an issue with.
May I come in on this as yeah. the non artist in the group? I was wondering, as I heard all of you speak, but particularly the curator, the artist, what has changed since the postmodern era? I mean, it's not the first time that we sit around talking about the instability of identities, about multiplicities and complexities, and yet something has shifted tremendously from when we did that back in the old days, when, you know, multiple identities, in my case, nomadic identities, flows and processes. Could we try to see what has changed? One is the scale, I think. A bacteria is not one bacteria, it's a colony, there are multitudes of them. We know that bacteria are eating out those plastic bottles in the Southern Oceans. They're eating away at them, and they're extraordinary, unstoppable, and inexhaustible, and always collectivity. So we know that a lot of that is going on. So is the scale what changes between Baudrillard and us, between postmodernism and what I call the posthuman moment? Is it the fact that now science is an interlocutor? We have Lars telling us how things really are. In the 80s and 90s, we wouldn't have had a scientist telling us how it really works. In fact, we wouldn't have cared. It was linguistic, it was cultural. Could we try to play with that? And ultimately, the question is for Protectorama at the end of the day.
Ooh, okay. I'm maybe not capable to have that sound trajectory as you were proposing. I'm very entertained by it, or like inspired by this question, but I don't think I can really answer it. I can only make a more profound like sort of delineation of what space I think we have here that you describe, like that we now share with scientists, we share with engineers, we share in the case of, for example, artificial intelligence. And in that, the paradigms have shifted. The artists are not maybe that independent anymore and that careless, as you were describing, or also the humanities. And also we have the science not being as positive as it was. I think that's right. So, but where is that space where that happens? We can say it's here, but there's few spaces where this can happen. And maybe it's a question of scale in terms of scaling up these spaces in which these hybridizations, these unclear, unreadable, anti-discipline moments can be nurtured. I don't know, it was maybe just a doubling down on what you said.
Yeah, thank you. I think so. What I see when you ask Rosie, what is changing? I think that what we see is an emerging of the of a kind of a global sensibility, and I think we deal with a lot of global problems, but we have no global sense for it because we are here and now, and that is good for it. But we need to have more a global sensitivity in a way, and because you said so, artists joining scientists is a very important thing. Because what I liked in your talk, Lars, was not only that you are so much in favor of microbes, but that you very often said, this is another aspect of it. This is another aspect of it. This is another aspect of it. And I think this is also a sign for multiplicity, which science can give us. So to look very carefully and to look at these different aspects, and to give us the insight into these different aspects, which is very important because we need the scientists. You have to do all the work to give us these insights, you know. We can't do this work. On the other hand, we see then from the artist side how you can use it in order to make it more sensible. I don't know if you can follow me, but we have no sense for this. We only have rhetorics for it. And this is something we also have to think about, new forms of rhetoric about talking about these things, I think. Because the rhetoric, at the end of the day, Rosie, keeps us in this sometimes very old borders of thinking. That is what I feel pretty much. But I have no idea how we could develop a new rhetoric in order to deal with it. Maybe you have an idea, Rosie.
New rhetoric about the collaborative assemblages. Well, it's where the question of experimenting with thinking becomes crucial. That's why thinking is what I continue to foreground. And it is a creative as well as a critical. We need fundamental labs to think about complex multiplicities, to think about metastability, to think about new modes of heterogeneous collaboration. We really need to have much more time and structures and resources to work on thinking in an era that is completely opposed to theory, totally opposed to a research in the humanities and culture, at least in the universities, in the teaching world. And so we rely more and more in what used to be called the arts world, which is the world where experimenting with thinking, to a certain extent, always happened. This is why I asked what has changed since the postmodern era. And in a sense, it always happened, but now it's accelerating more than ever as the universities become more kind of industrialized, as knowledge becomes monetarized, and as getting research funding means finding money for your research, and as the institutions become that way, it is the arts and cultural sector that is where experimenting with thinking takes place, and it's a very strange tension, and one that has been exacerbated, of course, by the pandemic, where there is a huge emergency. We have to find a solution. And it almost overrides any other consideration. So I think asking for respect for experimental ways of thinking and putting resources to it, completely against the stream of what is happening. And again, there are connections to the past. This was a request. I mean, Deleuze wrote in the 80s, philosophy is about the creation of new concepts. It's about creativity. The modernists were talking about, do we have a language to express our new industrial culture? There are continuities and profound discontinuities with modernity that we need to map out as we enter this post-human, non-human kind of universe. Sometimes I think that we are running out of time, that we will not have the resources to do this. It's certainly not in the institutions of learning. But then, of course, there is Olverein and there are other institutional settings. But we need to intensify, we need to ask what is the institutional structure that we need for experimenting with new ways of thinking. It's what the question that you people are asking, really.
Yes. I mean, what I see, we had a summer school last year with a lot of Asian students, and it was very interesting. And I see it, but I see it also in Europe, that the universities, especially the technological universities, go from this linear thinking into circular thinking, which is, I think, a very good sign. To think about technology in a circular way, that the things are renewable, that you have to be more sensitive. So that is something you also mentioned, that circular thinking is a very important aspect of it. It's not the only aspect, but it's a very important aspect, though.
Yeah. I fully agree. This also then suddenly requires a lot of collaboration. It was in a single we didn't think much about it, about the consequences in engineering, suddenly we have to think of end of life. We see it in our research that we look at customer perception. We have these examples, PR disasters of again my biofuel example. Yeah. In Germany, it was well meant. It was no problem for the environment. There was a technology. It was not too costly. It's actually even cheaper. It's subsidized in Germany, but no one buys it because it was a full PR disaster. So if you think circular, you have to talk with other people.
Yeah.
And I guess it's a good idea to be trained as a student. I agree. We see shifts also in our curricula, but it's not fast. It's not fast either.
If I may ask Lars, because I loved the way you approached the whole issue of the, as far as I can understand, that the collective nature of the bacterial colonies, the kind of immense vitality of this matter. Lynn Margulis is really, for me, a very crucial figure in this, but you are very aware of what a difficult life Lynn Margulis had when Richard Dawkins and the official biogenetics community accused her of being basically wrong, of being a bad poet with her symbiotic life and her circular thinking. And if you look at the documentary on Lynn Margulis, you literally hear Richard Dawkins saying to Margulis, but why are you talking about life as a holistic process of collaboration? With the selfish gene theory, we have the perfect theory to understand the linear evolution of the European man. We have a system that protects and defends our market economy. Lynn, why do you want to change this? And Lynn Margulis answers to the great Richard Dawkins, because, Richard, the evidence is out there. And I think that moment where you get what is the scientific truth, what counts as the scientific truth, it is still very, very difficult to defeat linearity in biological thinking, in scientific thinking. The battle is still on. It's shifting, I agree, but long way to go still. And if we could do the same thing for brain research, if you listen to Steve Pinker, it's all very linear and all very rational and all very teleological, as the evidence from everywhere else is the messiness, the circularity and the relational mess, really, the relational entanglements, as Karen Barad would say. So don't you think that you are in some ways a very revolutionary thinker, Lars, in going in that direction? Maybe you're freer than most.
Yeah, thanks. I I haven't thought it. So these 2 days are really teaching me a lot. But what I see also, how did microbiology work at least the last 120 years ago, maybe 150 years, trying to isolate this single microbe and work with it. It was a bad pathogen, it was a good baker's yeast. And for the last 10 years or so, we try really to understand communication. Okay, communication, we try to understand maybe the last 30 years, but it's complicated. But we try to understand also communities. And this is a big shift, but we see it's really important from producing a cheese, this is often not a single microbe, to us where we have thousands of different species living with us, and we obviously don't know how that works. But there is a shift also in the research.
Mm-hmm. Do we have questions from...
Yes, we have a few. Let me just pick one quickly. So this one comes from Shinit, from our participants, and she is asking about the position of, I think, biotechnology at this moment. She says, also keeping what Rosie has said last night about not shying away from complexity, Lars, do you find that you have to cheerlead for microbes, especially in a COVID landscape? Or do you feel that scientific communities allow for a non-black and white discussion? And maybe there would be another question that links to that from our website, which is, do you think that there would be change when people would not lack belief in the same way that they did in science, politics, etc., and creativity would become viable in its legitimacy, and so would collectivity and micro-grinding. So what would change if people would trust in creativity the same way they do in science?
Okay, my argument would be that it's not either or. You don't get progress, I would say, if you don't have creativity. You have to ask also the right questions. That would be, my direct reflex, but the other aspect, as a microbiologist, we obviously face also reality, and then it's not black and white. At the moment, we produce most of our products via chemical means, and the chemical industry will obviously go on, and the chemists are also creative, coming up with more sustainable synthesis routes. Maybe they can also use other carbon sources. They can. So it will be not all microbes at the end. So I think the discussion is out there. We try to evaluate it, how much energy is required, what are the impacts on the landscape if we take up new technologies. That was discussed also yesterday. What happens if you just change? Is that all the time better? There are all the examples where it might not. So I think the discussion is open, and hopefully the best ideas win and contribute that we come into something circular. But again, are we fast enough? Yeah.
But do you think so? I like what Rosie yesterday said, that we have this fear of climate change, but it's a Western fear, because there are so many communities who have faced catastrophes for so long, and they are more resilient to all this talking about climate change. So maybe only we are very aware or very fearful of the climate change, because the way we live is changing. But is there not a similar thing that we also have the very Western feeling that we will fix the problem? And are there other ways So this is just a question which came up with your answer now. So do you see any sign that solutions come from other unexpected areas?
I would like to kind of try to contribute something there, because I do not think that the even the idea of fixing it is fixed.
Yes.
Sorry to say, but I think this is really like taking from also Rosie, staying with the complexity and embracing it means to first acknowledge, and I think we as Westerners have to do a lot of work there, that we don't know anything, that we are really in a situation in which the complexity is growing, like we know more, we know deeper, but we know not wider. We don't know where we are. Like you were just giving this beautiful example of how we don't even know who's in us, who's sort of like how we are comprised of these millions of beings. That might be a bit kitschig, as we say in German, but I think it's a great metaphor, it's a great picture, it's a great image of how different our consciousness is to what we think we are and what we actually are. And I think this is what we first have to embody, is that we don't know that we are in a blind flight, and I mean specifically on a planetary scale. In when Johannes was a bit younger, he was talking to Norbert Renkle, who's working in the group Crisis, and he tried to like imagine a world society without money, which is obviously not such a new idea. You know, if we look at the modernist ideas of getting rid of profit, of surplus value, of value as such, and this is also his history. But he was basically asserting that's the only thing Johannes got from this text, and he transposes it to me now, is like we are in blind flight of how to even steer our economy. And I think that's pretty much what you also were illustrating. We don't know if the best ideas win, and we don't even know what's best. And I think that's something we in the West have to really face, is with all that technology and all of this deep knowledge into deep systems of energy production, of microbiomes, of technologies, on a large scale, on a wide knowledge scale, we have no clue. And I think this is how to fix it, is to first embody that, and then we'll see.
Thanks. Rosie, do you want to add something?
Well, the Socratic not knowing is, of course, the beginning of all wisdom, but we are in a complicated convergence, because I totally agree with Protector Rama that on the one hand, we don't have a clue how to fix this, if the scale of the climate change, if the melting of the permafrost means that the gas methane starts going into the atmosphere, well, that's irreversible. And that process seems to have started, and we don't know how to fix it. But at the same time, and it is the end of complete capitalism and schizophrenia. At the same time, we have geoengineering projects that are coming up with the most extraordinary ways in which we could fix the problem by spraying things into the atmosphere, by protecting the glaciers with layers of chemical material that would protect them. We have projects, serious projects with serious funding to mine minerals from the bottom of the oceans. We are sending probes out to Mars with the purpose of mining, of bringing down water. And it is all happening at the same time, extraordinary advances. Again, really extraterrestrial capitalism with enormous investments, while we can't fix the quality of our air and our water. It's that tension. I mean, synthetic biology, regenerative medicine, but at the same time, the labor that the Protector Rama pointed out so well, the labor of surrogacy, gestational labor, real primordial bodily labor. We're really in a moment of end. I think we need a massive communal a communitarian, community-driven effort to steer the process and say, okay, fine, to mine, to send, you know, spaceships to Mars because it has minerals that we need. But can we maybe take care of this planet also? At the end of the day, it's the notion of caring for this planet and caring for the people that are paying the heaviest price for being so close to the toxic material of the Earth. It's a question of solidarity, of responsibility. It's pretty one-on-one. But at the same time, there's a lot that we know, but very little that we give a damn for. And I think that is what really worries me. That's what keeps me awake at night.
Okay. So, but this is what I mean when we don't have a sense for it in a way. So it is very nice to see a spaceship starting to Mars. This is exciting, you know. This is thrilling in a way. We like that. But caring has not this thrilling part, and we need to have more a sense for that in order, in contrast to have this thrilling aspect of seeing. Rocket start. I think it has a lot to do with feelings, with emotions, and these things. I don't know. Maybe you can.
Yeah, maybe that's where you early introduced me as a curator, where I wouldn't even want to claim that position to speak from. That's why I said I think I identified as a practitioner or something of techno-social techniques, meaning with this curating or making exhibitions. Or facilitating relations or something. And I think maybe this is where art, when we think of embodied knowledge or exhibition making, can suggest a horizon to think in. Mm-hmm. I would actually be interested also in Rosie Bradotti's notion in the nomadic subject and how this goes together with a more rooted or located embodied knowledge. Mm-hmm. Because I think this is something that arts or facilitating arts is grappling with a lot at the moment, especially.
Rosie, do you want to answer it?
Yeah, it's a big question. But, to be in movement, to be nomadic, actually, has got a long, complicated history. But the roots of it is numos. It comes from the land. It comes from being grounded and situated. But then you move between locations. It's not an endless drifting. It is itineraries and it is. Motions and I used it as with Deleuze, with Spinoza, with that phase of my thinking, to move beyond this idea of that being a subject means being really grounded, located, one equal to itself. And there was already an attempt to instability, to opening, and to variations, that you can be many different things, contradictory things. It was a transformation and transversality, but it never was meant to be unhinged. My favorite line is from Virginia Woolf, "I am rooted, but I flow. I am grounded, but I move. I belong to multiple locations. My bacteria is as much me as the synapses in my brains. We are a multiplicity." It was moving in that direction with a kind of very little nostalgia for the sovereign transcendental notion of the subject, which is still so terribly important, the narcissism of that subject that is in charge of the course of his life. And the bloated narcissistic subject. Can I just add that when Félix Guattari, back in the 80s, early 90s, is writing one of the big treatises on ecology, the three ecologies, which is an extraordinary text about the ecologies of society, environmental and psychic, the affective, the social and the environmental, and is warning us that technology will go really down exactly the way that it went, towards making money, profit, delusionality, and that it will infantilize us. It will make us dependent on patterns of communication and representation that are really bad for us. And yet we will keep going back for more, like kids or like addicts, taking another shot of media-induced stupidity. And then he looks at the example. He says there is an example of the type of subject that represents where we are going. It's 1992, and Félix Guattari chooses Donald Trump as the example. Go and look it up in the Three Ecologies. Prescient, like this kind of big baby with nuclear power. And I think that that sick, toxic subject is something that we have been fighting against, nomadic subjects of all kinds, for decades, forever. A long way to go, but we have to have that flexibility, that openness, meta-stability, experimenting, not nostalgia. It's time to move on. And I think, again, the artists, practitioners have done amazing work. The first posthuman exhibition is in Munich in 95. It's the first posthuman exhibition. It's 95. It's very interesting, an incredibly interesting exhibition. At the cusp between postmodernism and posthumanism, an extraordinary moment where already all of these ideas are bursting open, miles ahead of anything that we can do in philosophy departments or even in cultural studies departments. So, complicated answer, but I wanted to throw it back at you.
Yeah, but I want to ask, come back to the question of rhetoric. So it's not one of the biggest problem, especially of Western world, that we have only one word for me, because and this is something we learned yesterday so nicely, I as we is so unusual, you have to get used to it. I once did a seminar in Berlin on language, on philosophy of language, and all the participants, the students, came from Asia, and they have 8 different forms for me related to the social environment. And this was so interesting because with this idea of 8 different me's, you cannot develop ego cogito ego sum from Descartes, because there is not this single ego.
Consequently, you can't invent modern science, and consequently, you can't invent colonialism and all the things that made the West what it was.
Exactly. So that is the nucleus, you know? That is the nucleus.
I agree. But, you know, modernism, James Joyce, Virginia Woolf, they already attack this. High modernism, you know, they write these books where there is no I. The Waves of Virginia Woolf, what is the subject? It's actually things. And The Waves is an extraordinary text. And so it's the experimentation with that goes into high modernism. And then it flops out and becomes a series of other things. I think the rise of technology, the rise of the media is absolutely crucial there. Because in some ways, Facebook gives you a face, gives you a place, reinstates your molecular molarity. You become a microfascist, to quote my favorite philosophers, almost inevitably. So there is an effect of reterritorialization that comes from the technology, but we have prototypes of criticism of that unitary subject going way back to the first part of the 20th century. Again, literature and the arts.
So what was your experience in Asia with that?
I didn't go into the specifics of linguistics, but I totally think that I as us comes or was at some point also sort of shot through what you were mentioning, the other linguistics that are different than from what I grew up with as Johannes, as Protectorama, becoming these multiplicities. But there's also the way I as us have developed, there's also the question of, is there not many more forms of we? And I think that's maybe crucial to add. That also comes from certain linguistics, different forms in different world languages to include or exclude people from the we. And I think there's almost algorithmic forms in some indigenous languages in Australia that basically kind of work in derivatives of we as you progress through times. And it's incredibly inspiring, incredibly rich embodied knowledge that we can draw from these forms of linguistics. And I would argue that what we see in what Rosie just mentioned in the West is making the eye a technology, making it efficient, making it streamlined along the idea of disenchanting the world, making it less complex for this very mono-identical or identitist eye. So you can exert power, you can exert colonial force, you can move through the universe as if you were one. And I think it's absolutely crucial to revoice this again and again, that this eye is a technology that we need to overcome. It's one of the pathogens, if I may say so.
Yeah, that is great. But we have one bacteria here and another, or microbe. Is it a bacteria?
It's
and another one here. So this is the same idea embodied in this Plüschtiere. I don't know the English word for it. So Lars, I know that we talk always about a microbe, but you said there are colonies, there are millions, billions of it. And so this is very scientific now. You have to talk quantitatively, so statistically about it, which is also challenging because it doesn't fit to the object-oriented thinking of the eye. Is this an experience you have as a scientist?
Maybe I managed to come back to that. I had an idea just when we look at our microbiome. So this is majorly, if you look mass-wise into your gut, there's obviously skin, et cetera. There are also microbes everywhere. It's a diversity. If there's suddenly one, then suddenly even a Baker's yeast, there are examples, suddenly even a Baker's yeast is a pathogen. If it's only a Baker's yeast, there are patients out there, if they eat something sweet, what does a Baker's yeast do? Produce ethanol, they're drunk when they eat some sweets. And so it's even their pathogen, if they lose most of their others. So that was just this individual to the community or to the mixture. Do I have a? I think I can't make shift back to your aspect. I'm sorry.
It's not a problem. We have a very important question now.
Yeah, I have two questions. They're connected, but they're even separate. I have a question in relation, it's from Juan Pablo, to the materiality of emerging technologies. Despite the discussion on biotechnologies, most of our devices still depend on the violent extraction of minerals, mostly in the global south, including this very conference. Most techno fixes, geoengineering and bioengineering seem to highly depend on these minerals, directly contributing to extractive practices of mining and labor exploitation. How to relate to this paradox? That's the first question. And it's connected. It's a question from Inke. Mars mining or deep sea mining represent a continuation of the economic model that has led to the total devastation of our planet. Caring would mean a radical shift in this economy, no?
Yeah. Who wants, Rosie? Yeah, it's a question for you, I think.
Do I start? Who want?
Yeah, please.
Okay, so fantastic questions. And we can start the seminar and the symposium all over again and spend the next 3 months coming to terms with them. Yes, 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 of course. The toxic materiality of the emerging technologies. I thought that these two days, the speakers, the work done, stressed that aspect quite well. The messiness, the toxic nature of it, the labor questions, our phone, our laptops, those batteries, the components, the lithium, the mining. There's a lot of really good research on what people call the geology of media. I'm thinking indeed of Yusof, but also Parika, Jennifer Gabris, Matthew Fuller. There's a whole materialist school of media studies that says follow the minerals, follow the earth. Don't believe for a minute that this technology is clean or paperless. Follow the meta mothers of the surrogacy industry. Follow real bodies involved in this thick, dense materiality. So the extraction economy and their continuum with colonialism, absolutely central. I think it's time to look at this economic model and say it's unsustainable. We have to change. But indeed, Mars mining, deep sea mining is a continuation of it. And what's happening up in the North Pole with the defrosting of the Barents Passage, the struggle between Russia, Norway, Denmark, and the United States about who owns the floor of the ocean, which is full of minerals. You know that Russia has planted a flag at the bottom of the sea. And the Americans have planted a flag on the moon. We're planting flags in a neo-colonial manner in the most absurd places. So it is a disturbing continuation of a flawed and failed neo-colonial capitalist extraction economy model. And it's absolutely urgent to put a stop to it. But somebody go and talk to, these new venture capitalists that are betting on other planets. The first lived colony on the moon is being prepared right now, preparing the first settlement in the moon so that we can go on to Mars. It's not science fiction. It's happening under our very noses. So caring and the left behinds becomes almost a science fiction plot come true. But yes, I completely agree. A flawed, failed, disastrous economic model. Time to change.
Johannes, sorry.
I would like to maybe point this question also a bit towards this, like the conversation we had before and the continuous question of I as us, because imbued in that is implicit in that idea is I as you, or I as us was mentioning this in the narration of my own beingness, is that there is a shift between what is me and what is you. And I think that what the audience member was just proposing is this immersion of even this conference, in which we have this model of critiquing the capitalism, mining, extractivism, whereas we are immersed in it ourselves. And this, I think, is interesting to mention. I think that's one of the shifts that we are hopefully realizing, is that there is not this I and you and an inside and an outside, but that there is an immersion of the I and the you with one another across the planet, yes, but also in the idea that there is not such a thing that we can break through to the other side immediately and make a political reversal of the societies and the technologies that we have as humans invented. And I think that's very important, because that gives you the ability to not think tomorrow everything is going to be good and we are now very bad, or I is bad and you is good, but to kind of work through things continuously. And I think that's a real engine or a real power, a real energy to change, to transform.
Thanks. Was there another question?
There was a very practical point to it, I understood, and this is that if we fix the carbon, we run into copper or whatever other minerals we need to grow this biomass. And sure, we have to look into it, and all the recycling people tell us there's no 100% of recycling. So we have to reduce our linear model very quickly. But then we have to come up with ideas what happens with what we can't recycle. Is that then still enough to be sustainable? But yeah, that was more a practical aspect of that question.
Yeah. And I mean, yesterday it was questioned that the Anthropocene is not such an interesting concept. And I was always stuck by the point that the Anthropocene has also such an egomanic a notion, we made it, we have left a trace, you know. The trace is bad. It's either rubbish or it's extinction. But at the end, we have written ourselves into the global history of the planet. It always had this negative notion, and we can only hope that it's reversible. But what you said now is it's not that reversible, probably, for some things. Maybe we can reverse some carbon dioxide, which is also a big business, because in the oceans there is so much carbon dioxide stored that it will take 100 years to bring this out, to see an effect in the atmosphere, and so on and so on. So it's really a long, ongoing business we have to face, and it's not good tomorrow, I would say. Are we over time, or we have no idea? We're just talking and discussing all the time.
Very nice to listen to you. We have one last question from our online audience.
Yeah.
I would give it to you. It's to Rosie. Dear Rosie, as scientists, we all stand on the shoulders of giants, and we are bound to traditions of thought. With the multitude of new results and new approaches in science, combining ideas becomes complex. How can we learn to think outside the box, to integrate ideas of different disciplines without being anthropocentric?
What a fabulous question. All of tonight we've turned around the question, who is we, and when are we? And I think maybe if we start from the composition of a subjectivity that is a complex, that is an assembly. Me, my bacteria, my iPhone, my friends, my multiple selves, my virtual bodies, the communities of scientists that I relate to. Me is a very distributed, extended model. And maybe we have a chance. And in a sense, it is a pre-modern model of the self, and I've been reading much more of Spinoza and Spinoza with Deleuze, with Althusser of late, because there is no subject in Spinoza. We're all part of something he calls nature. We're all part of compounds. I'm reading indigenous epistemologies because we're all part of continuums. We don't have to be so obsessed with this me, and I. So we have to unlearn certain habits. At the same time, my appeal as a woman of science is not to drop out of science. And we've heard scientists like Lars, but there are many others who are very open to processes of transformations. We can do knowledge differently. We can unlearn certain bad habits, learn new ones together. I think the idea of the commons, the commons is the alternative to the alternative to what capitalism became. It's a pre-modern economy of sharing and making computers that we can repair, that can last 15 years. Why do we have technology with planned obsolescence that we have to change every 2 years? Make machines that last for 15, open up repair shops, use less resources, get a life, as we say in Melbourne, get a life, a life, grounded, imminent, shared. So I think it is a very exciting time. Don't drop out of science. Let's do it differently, transdisciplinary, with conversations with friendly scientists and open scientists who are citizens, who care, who give a damn for the planet. Let's talk to the venture capitalists and say, can you invest some money in poverty and not just invest money in profit? Can you invest money in solidarity and not only in more geoengineering and extractive economies? Can we talk about the importance of putting money in towards somehow causes that are lost, that are not going to make us richer? Can we change the social imaginary and all of us desire less, fewer gadgets, and learn to be poor again, to repair again? Can we become a little bit more monastic? Is almost a term. It's almost a medieval idea, pre-modern, but do not give up on the scientific model. We need alternative science. We need socially responsible science. We need science for the margins, for the excluded, for experimenting with our own complexities. So science otherwise.
Great. Can we go on? Or so a statement from you would be nice.
After this grand finale. I hand this to Rosie. This was a great plaidoyer, and I just will give this the space to resonate. I think that's very important, and I think we should leave it at this.
Then we leave it by that. Thank you all for this discussion. It was really interesting. Thank you for listening. And I heard you have on Sunday, you have a workshop. And can you do a Planetary Alliance Manifesto? Because I think we definitely need this to go on in the right directions. Thank you. Good night.